Good morning. I'm the Reverend Jay Brooks, and together with the Reverend Jennifer Brower and the Reverend Dr. Natalie Fenimore, we welcome you to this online worship service at the Unitarian Universalist Congregation at Shelter Rock. Wednesday was Earth Day, a day to celebrate our planet and recommit ourselves to its protection and care. This idea is embodied in our seventh Unitarian Universalist principle, respect for the interdependent web of existence of which we are a part. Our Green Sanctuary Committee helps our congregation live into this principle. Today, in honor of Earth Day and the seventh principle, we're lifting up a group of children and youth who, in an unusual lawsuit, have challenged the United States government to protect our planet from the negative effects of climate change. It is an unusual lawsuit, but what's not so unusual is the leadership of these children and youth. We see youth leaders rising everywhere, and their message about the effect of climate change is not just for the government and the courts. It touches all of us. I'm grateful for the initiative of these young leaders. And this morning, I'm grateful as well that for this worship service, our Shelter Rock children and youth have lifted their voices to share the words and vision of these remarkable young people.
We enter into this service with the words of Richard Hendrick in his work Lockdown. They say that in Wuhan, after so many years of noise, that you can hear the birds again. They say that after just a few weeks of quiet, the sky is no longer thick with fumes, but blue and gray and clear. They say that in the streets of Assisi, people are singing to each other across the empty squares, keeping their windows open so that those who are alone may hear the sounds of family and others around them.
They say that a hotel in the west of Ireland is offering free meals and delivery to the homebound. Today, a young woman I know is busy spreading flyers with her number through the neighborhood so that the elders may have someone to call on. Today, churches, synagogues, mosques, and temples are preparing to welcome and shelter the homeless, the sick, and the weary.
All over the world, people are slowing down and reflecting. All over the world, people are looking at their neighbors in a new way. All over the world, people are waking up to a new reality, to how big we really are, to how little control we really have, to what really matters, to love.
To set this time apart as sacred and special time during the week, we kindle the flame of our chalice, the symbol of Unitarian Universalism.
Thank you. People wonder why we're suing the U.S. government over something as big and out there as climate change. But for me, it's not out there. A few weeks ago, I literally stepped out of bed and was up to my ankles in climate change. They called it a 1,000-year flood, meaning it should only happen every 1,000 years or so. But in my state, Louisiana, we have had that 1,000-year flood and 8 500-year floods in less than 2 years. My family's home was destroyed in that flood. So for me, it's personal. It's now. It's where I live. Or not.
I grew up in Port Orchard, Washington, at the end of a half-mile dirt road. I learned about Buddhism and herbalism from my mom. When I was 12, I joined Plant for the Planet. It's a youth-led group that has planted 14 billion trees worldwide. Would you be willing to change places with me? I'm 17 now. I'm fit, I have my whole life ahead of me. I'm a super fast reader, I'm crazy about vanilla bean ice cream, I recently fell in love with snowboarding, I play a little ukulele and I sing, and oh, a few years ago I sued the Washington state government for a cleaner climate and won. On the downside, however, I'm a little disorganized. I don't clean my room as much as I should. My mom says I worry too much. I can't vote, and though I sued the government, nothing's changed. I have my whole life ahead of me, but it's filled with melting ice shelves, monster storms, and air that's not breathable. Still want to change places with me? I know that suing the federal government seems a bit extreme, but the government hasn't been held accountable for the failure to protect the life and future lives on this planet, forcing us children to take drastic actions to save life on this planet.
I learned about climate change from my grandfather. He's a famous climate scientist, Dr. James Hansen. He was born in Iowa, studied at the University of Iowa, and now he works in New York City at Columbia University. He's a scientist that helped the world understand the damage that greenhouse gases can do. Growing up around him, our family holiday dinners were about global warming, its effects, and what we can still do to stop the greenhouse effect. I might have thought it was all just talk, but the superstorm Hurricane Sandy hit Pennsylvania and climate change suddenly seemed very real. And it's definitely not out there. Our power was out because of Superstorm Sandy. Hailstorms damaged our house. Sometimes I can't get to school because of floods or tornado warnings. And this isn't like the beach. It's Allentown, Pennsylvania. Definitely not a normal target zone for hurricanes, floods, and tornadoes. But hey, climate change, life's different already. And very soon it could be very different, not in a good way. I see what's happening and I understand what's happening. And if today we don't stop climate change, it will harm me. It's already harming me. And the entire fabric of human civilization and all living things on Earth. So it's big, and it's right here.
Your ministry team has been reflecting on how Shelter Rock, as a loving religious community, might offer support for those who are most affected during this time of coronavirus. Our chaplains, our community captains, our caring committee, and many youth and young adults in our religious education community are deeply engaged in offering support and care to members of the Shelter Rock family. But what about those in the wider world who need support and care? The offering this week benefits the Long Island Council of Churches food pantry on the South Shore. It is one of the few remaining food pantries on Long Island. This is a time of great need for families whose breadwinners have lost their jobs. Many Long Island soup kitchens and food pantries have closed. The Long Island Council of Churches food pantry is still open, but they are rapidly running out of supplies and could use your help. There are multiple ways to give. Choose the method that is most convenient for you. If you choose to donate through the website, click on the donate button and then choose special collection. As you reflect on the amount of your contribution and how you would like to give, Consider these words of the Sufi poet Rumi. If the entire world is covered with the blossoms you have labored to plant, what do you think will happen? If the elixir of life that has been hidden in the dark fills the deserts and towns, what do you think will happen? If, because of your generosity and love, a few humans find their lives, what do you think will happen?
I'm from Eugene, Oregon. Our only source of water is the Mackenzie River. It's fed by melting snowpack. Emphasis on melting, what happens when it's gone. I love being outdoors, especially in the solitude of the wilderness. Outdoor sports are kind of my thing, skiing, rafting, being outside in the clean air. But look what's happening to our air, our water, our beaches, our ski areas. My mom usually works at the Willamette Pass Ski Resort, but because of changing snow levels, she didn't have work last winter. And less snow means less water. Climate change may have a different impact in different places. In some places, there's too much water. But the bottom line is the same if you ask this question. What do people need to live? They need clean air. They need clean water. That's what matters. I've been lobbying for years, asking my state and local governments to take action to protect the earth from climate change. Even if Oregon and the city of Eugene respond to protect the climate, it's a much bigger challenge. The federal government needs to step up. They need to be doing a lot more to protect our futures. That's why I decided to join the lawsuit, The Future Matters.
Where I live, in Oregon, we're already seeing the effects of climate change. Or I should say, feeling the effects of climate change. It's not just the decreasing water levels. It's also the overall increase in dryness, which has increased the frequency of forest fires. I love being outdoors, but I have asthma. These days, the air is hotter and drier. Hot, dry air makes my asthma worse. And when there's smoke from forest fires, how many of you know what it feels like not to be able to breathe? Yeah. What matters is that people are able to breathe. Kids are able to breathe. Kids like me, kids now and in the future, need to be able to breathe. So that's why I joined this lawsuit. For me, for other kids, for kids of the future, for breathing. I want my children and future generations to be able to live safely on our planet. That's what matters.
Isaac V, age 15, Beaverton, Oregon. I didn't really know what I was getting into when I was in the fifth grade and decided to do my science fair project on carbon footprints and global warming. But once I began to understand what was going on, I knew I had to do something. I went to hear climate activist Bill McKibben speak about his fossil fuel divestment program. Fossil fuels increase our carbon footprint, and carbon dioxide is one of the major causes of global warming. I went up to him after the lecture. I asked him, "Do you think that an 11-year-old can get a city like Beaverton, Oregon, to join your divestment campaign?" His answer was yes. So like I said, I had to do something. Most people know that climate change is happening, but they push it aside so they can move on with their lives. What matters to me is living my values. I'm Jewish, and living in an ethical way is important in my tradition. For my bar mitzvah project, I collected more than 500 signatures on a petition to get Beaverton to stop using fossil fuels. And I spoke before the Beaverton City Council. It hasn't happened yet, but I'm not giving up. And I joined this lawsuit because I'm speaking for future generations. Kids who want to have a livable planet as they grow up. That's what really matters.
I invite you to join now in meditating upon the words of Kristen Flintz in her poem, Stop. We are asking you to stop, to be still, to listen, to move beyond your individual concerns and consider the concerns of all, to be with your unknown, your ignorance, to find your humility, to relinquish your thinking minds and travel deep into the mind of the heart. We're asking you to look up into the sky, streaked with fewer planes, and see it, to notice its condition, clear, smoky, smoggy, rainy. How much do you need that sky to be healthy so that you may also be healthy? We're asking you to look at a tree, to see it, to notice its condition. How does its health contribute to the health of the sky, to the air you need to be healthy? We're asking you to visit a river, to see it, to notice its condition, clear, clean, murky, polluted. How much do you need it to be healthy so that you may also be healthy? How does its health contribute to the health of the tree, who also contributes to the health of the sky, so that you may also be healthy?
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue.
Nick V, age 16, Lakewood, Colorado. I've always loved the outdoors, especially fishing, but where I live in Colorado, wildfires, water shortages, and floods, sometimes all in the same year, have kept me away from the river for the past 3 years. And hey, I'm only 16. My family used to grow some of our own food, but the weather's been so weird. Hail, heavy rain, drought, and pests, some of the invasive species
have ruined our garden. All of these are symptoms of climate change. Climate impacts in the U.S. are real and getting worse. We're running out of water, we're facing record-setting heat waves, and wildfires and superstorms are becoming more and more common. We must act now to protect our planet and our civilization. For me, this is a moral call to protect the common good and not the profits of a selfish few. I'm a Catholic, and my faith is important to me. In 2015, when Pope Francis issued his encyclical on care for our common home, I was inspired. Joining in a lawsuit to ask the federal government to protect our planetary home was a no-brainer for me. I'm honored and blessed that many Catholic groups have come on board to support the cause. The need for immediate and wide-scale action to protect the Earth's climate is a defining fact of our lives today. Think about it. My world has already changed. The greed of a few is overwhelming the world that I knew. I think we have a really good chance of winning. It's hard for legal experts to deny the rights of young people. We're the future. Me, my kids, their grandkids. It's our lives.
I live on an island off the coast of Florida. It's 13 feet above sea level. All my life, I had to deal with algae blooms and monster storms. And all the plastic junk that was washed up on the beach. I've been on a beach cleaning volunteering since I can remember. Climate change is making hurricanes bigger and bigger. After Hurricane Matthew, I helped replant the sand dunes. After Hurricane Irma, I didn't have to go to school anymore. I'm homeschooled now because the storms destroyed my school. We have to find a way of nature, a way to work with the earth. Lots of kids visit their grandparents in a home they've had for years. By the time I'm a parent, my home won't exist anymore. By the time I'm a grandparent, my island won't exist anymore. So much of my life centers on the effect of climate change. Mom and I are Unitarian Universalists. One of our principles is for the interdependent web of existence. The damage on climate change is all about human disrespect. I was 8 years old when my minister told my mom about the climate change protection lawsuit. Mom said, "Do you want to join?" And I was like, "Yes," because it's all about our lives.
I was raised in the Aztec tradition. The main thing I remember about my childhood is being outside in the forest with my dad, searching for frogs and snakes. It made me feel like I was such a big part of the world. Indigenous peoples see themselves as caretakers of the planet. But I learned about human lifestyles, how our greed and ways of living are destroying our planet for profit. It freaks me out. Since I was 6 years old, I've been giving speeches about the need to protect the Earth from climate change. I've written a book on climate change. It's called We Rise. My Kickstarter campaign is funding a hip-hop album with my songs about the Earth, and any money from it will support climate education. But I gotta say, kids shouldn't have to be the one on the front line of climate change. It's the job of our leaders to take action for us. That's what our lawsuit is about. When I was 15, I gave a speech to the UN about stopping climate change. Compared to the other things I do, the UN was very sterile. Everyone was in a suit and tie playing on their phones. Nobody cared. I'm used to performing at music festivals where the crowd is much more engaged. I'm a climate activist, but based on what I've seen, I'll never be a politician. It would drain my soul of everything that's pure. People tell me I should run for president. I think, no, I shouldn't. It's important to stay close to your vision and stay humble. I'll never cut my hair. Climate change is the defining issue of our time. It's about more than science or law or politics. It's about our lives.
I love cross-country skiing. I've skied competitively since I was little, really little. So a few years ago, it was a shock when suddenly there wasn't enough snow to ski. I mean, all my life. Skiing was my life. Now nothing. I set out to learn about climate change and how to stop it. I've always assumed that the United States government had my best interests in mind. This is not always the case. I know that now. Because the government knew about climate change, knew about the science. The future is such jeopardy, and they know. I understand that we can't lead zero emissions lives yet, but we need to start somewhere. And the government needs to lead the way. It should have our best interests in mind. When I was growing up, I didn't understand that I had the capacity to be heard in the political system. Now I do. Activism is both fighting to change what one doesn't like in the system and working with this within the system to make an active change. There's a balance. For much of history, governments felt they had an inherent duty to protect resources. They called it the public trust. The public trust is a part of a basis of our lawsuit. We're asking the court to make the government do the right thing for us now, for all people in the future. Our prayer for relief, what we want, is for the court to tell the government to create a national plan to stabilize the climate system. Our prayer for relief is that the government protect the vital resources that all of us depend on, and that all of us will depend on in the future. This is our prayer.
We close our worship service today with these words from the poem Lockdown by Richard Hendrick. Wake to the choices you make as to how to live now. Today, breathe. Listen behind the factory noises of your panic. The birds are singing. The sky is clearing. Spring is coming, and we are always encompassed by love. Open the windows of your soul, and though you may not be able to touch across the empty square, sing.